सहस्रशीर्षा पुरुषः सहस्राक्षः सहस्रपाद स भूमिं विश्वतो वृत्त्वा अत्यतिष्ठद्दशाङ्गुलम् पुरुष एवेदकं सर्वम् यद्भूतै यच्च भव्यम्।
वेलकम महाराज धीरतव्रत, द किंग ऑफ ट्रावणकोर।
पुजारी जी, काइंडली डू नॉट एवर कॉल मी अ किंग अगेन, एंड एस्पेशली नॉट इन फ्रंट ऑफ अनंत पद्मनाभ जी। ही अलोन इज द किंग ऑफ ऑल दैट बी, एंड सर्टनली ही इज द किंग ऑफ ट्रावणकोर एज वेल। आई एम सिंपली हिज रिप्रेजेंटेटिव, हिज मीनियल सर्वेंट एंड नथिंग मोर।
Your surrender and devotion unto the Lord is exemplary. All glories unto you, and all glories unto the real King.
O Lord and King, please accept my humble obeisances. As has been the custom of my ancestors of the Chera dynasty since centuries, the rulers of our kingdom appointed as king by you have been faithfully coming here daily twice to report the ongoings of the kingdom to you. Since you are the king, you have a right to know, and it is my duty to report the same to you every day without fail. Today, we had a check of our granaries and estimated that our granaries are full of grains, which should last for at least the next 3 years. As your representative, I assure you that not a single soul shall go hungry in your kingdom. O King, I have taken another very important decision today in consultation with my ministers. We will provide financial aid and other facilities to the needy pilgrims who desire to undertake pilgrimage unto the holy places of Sri Rangam, Tirupati, and also to this holy abode of yours. That's all for the day, my lord. I'd like to spend a few minutes alone with thy lordship.
As you command, sir.
Dear lord, you have given me everything, opulence, power, fame, prestige, except a child. Therefore, somewhere deep within, I feel incomplete. This lamentation is not just of a father alone who desires the fulfillment of paternal emotions, or one who desires oblations for his forefathers, but also of a ruler who desires to have a competent son who can take over the reins of the kingdom and continue to serve the subjects faithfully as your representative. O Lord, kindly have compassion upon me, and if you so desire, then kindly bless this kingdom with a heir who will be your unalloyed devotee and who will rule this kingdom after me according to the principles of dharma.
The Lord, being Bhakta Vatsala, fulfilled this desire of Dhiratavrat, and you were soon blessed with a son. Though the exact date of birth is not available, Dhiratavrat and Nadanaiki's son was born somewhere around 767 Common Era on the banks of Periyar near Thiruvanaikulam, present-day Kozhikode in Kerala. He was sent by the Lord himself. Legend has it that this son was an incarnation of the Kaustubh Mani adorned by the Lord. Dhiratavrat named his son Kulashekhar, whom the world later knew as Kulashekhar Alwar.
Congratulations, Your Highness. For yet again, you have comprehensively defeated the Chola King in the recently concluded war. We have fought many battles with them. But due to your astute leadership, your meticulous planning, and your ability to inspire confidence and self-belief amongst our ranks, every time we have conquered them. By doing so, not only have we secured our boundaries, but also expanded them.
Today, you are the undisputed ruler of 3 out of 4 South Indian states. Your valor is unconquerable, and your fame is spreading in all directions like wildfire.
There is only one person deserving of all this praise. Shri Hari. It is his kingdom, and he is making me act. I am simply his instrument. If he wants, he can make us win many more battles and further expand his kingdom. And should he desire that I be nothing but just a pauper, then I am willing to be just that. Let us never forget that the goal of life is not to be more and more powerful and prosperous, but only to serve him in pure love and devotion. Anyways, it is now time to report today's proceedings to Anand Padmanabhji. Let us leave.
Wake up, my dear son Kulashekhar.
Oh Lord, oh Master.
My dear son, you are undoubtedly a great king, but great kings come and go with the passage of time. The one who is truly rare and precious is my devotee. And know for certain that you are my very special devotee. You have been sent here with a mission. You have conquered all directions with your prowess. Now the time has come for you to show to the world the art of conquering God. And that is through pure love.
Hey Karunanidhi, I do not desire this royalty, nor do I crave for wealth. I do not desire even to become the ruler of the 3 worlds. I'd rather be born as a simple stone step at the entrance of your temple, so that I can be stepped upon by your devotees and the celestials who come to visit you. Only after being smeared by the dust from their holy feet upon my head can I hope to be a recipient of your causeless mercy.
Son, in recognition of your praiseworthy desire, I assure you that for the ages to come, the steps leading to the sanctum sanctorum of Vaishnavite shrines will be known as Kulashekhar Tirupatti. In your honor, meaning Kulashekhar Sacred Steps. Tathastu.
Indeed, after this wonderful dream, King Kulashekhar lost all interest in his kingly affairs and would constantly lament about not being able to fully dedicate himself to the loving devotional service of the Lord.
How unfortunate I am that I am saddled with the burden of ruling this vast kingdom. I shall never abandon my responsibilities. However, it is a fact that this responsibility keeps me away from my Lord. How I wish to leave behind all of this and go away to Tirupati and take darshan of Lord Balaji. Or go away to Srirangam and serve Lord Ranganath day and night. Or to become a simple mendicant in the precincts of our own Ananta Padmanabh temple and just keep on singing his hymns. Oh, trusted ministers, you are my well-wishers. I request all of you to kindly empathize with my suffering. Please find a suitable person who can look after the kingdom after me and thus relieve me of my responsibilities. I trust that you will help me out of my suffering and will not disappoint me.
This certainly is a very precarious situation. The king is talking about leaving everything and becoming a saint.
A kingdom without a king is an orphan kingdom and is vulnerable to all kinds of attacks.
Besides, there is nobody who can look after the kingdom the way he does. Our subjects simply love him and will not be able to tolerate his departure.
We must stop him from retiring by all means.
Yes!
But how?
Vaishnavas. Vaishnavas are the representatives of the Lord. And our king? Our king has the greatest of regards for them. So let us regularly invite saintly people into our kingdom, so that through them, the king will feel connected to the Lord. This way, the king will be preoccupied in serving them and side by side serve the kingdom too.
Great idea.
Let's go and catch some Vaishnavas.
Yes, let's go. Brother, what do you mean by catch some Vaishnavas? It sounded as if you're saying, let's trap some Vaishnavas. You are pathetic.
As per the agreement between the ministers, every now and then, great Vaishnavas would be invited to the kingdom. King Kulashekhar would serve these saintly people with utmost devotion and feel great contentment. But as soon as the saint would leave, feelings of retirement would resurface in the heart of King Kulashekhar. To pacify him, another saint would be immediately brought in. In this way, quite a few years passed by. King Kulashekhar had made a practice to hear from the Ramayana every day. It so happened that one day, while hearing the Ramayana,
while in Panchavati, Ram, Sita and Lakshman had built a beautiful kutir for themselves. Despite the austere surroundings, they passed their time happily. One day, Ravana's sister, Supanka, happened to pass by their cottage and she saw them. She was thoroughly enchanted with Ram's beauty and she proposed to him, but he declined, citing that he is committed to only one wife. He jestfully suggested that she could instead try for Lakshman, but he too refused politely. Holding Mother Sita to be the cause of her being turned down, an envious Supanka tried to attack her. But Lakshman immediately cut off her nose. Spurned, Supanka left. But seeking revenge, returned with her brothers Khar and Dushan, who brought with them 14,000 mystic demon soldiers to attack them. Instructing Lakshman to guard Mother Sita, Ram prepared to face Khar, Dushan and their vast army all by himself.
Ministers! Khar and Dushan, along with their 14,000 mystic demons, have attacked Lord Ram in Panchavati. Our Lord is all alone in his fight. But we can't leave him alone. Prepare our army to leave for Panchavati to the Lord's aid right now. Haven't you heard what I just said?
King, it seems there is some confusion. This incident from Ramayana happened lakhs of years ago in Treta Yuga. It is a past event. It is history.
Nonsense! The fight is happening right now.
But, oh master.
No ifs and buts. There is no time to lose. Prepare to leave with our army this very instant. Oh saint, kindly offer me your blessings so that I can duly assist the Lord in his battle and help him emerge victorious. Oh Lord Ram, oh Master, I am coming! I am coming!
Looks like our king is in delirium. He's imagining things.
He has gone crazy.
Never before have I witnessed a level of absorption so deep in hearing Harikatha, to the extent that one transcends the boundaries of time and hears the Katha as if he were witnessing the incidents of the Katha live. The intensity of his Shravanam is unparalleled. He is madly in love with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. For the king, the past has become the present. Yes, he is in delirium, but his delirium is transcendental. You think he's crazy? But to be crazed like this, in love of God, is the perfection of one's existence. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
But what do we do now? The king is waiting for us.
We do not have a choice but to be a part of this madness. And Panchavati, for God's sake, is thousands of miles away.
I have an idea. Look, the king is not in his right frame of mind to understand the truth from the myth. So let us play along with him in his disillusionment and trick him in his state of delirium.
Look, we have had enough. Can you not bombard us with these esoteric words and be more clear, please?
Let us send a small battalion of our soldiers, along with our army commander-in-chief, ahead of us. At a certain point, let them turn back and approach us in the reverse direction, in a jubilant mood, claiming that the war is over and Lord Ram has emerged victorious.
You truly are one hell of a politician, aren't you? Let's go.
Oh Lord Ram, I am coming to your aid. Just give me some more time. Have patience, O Lord, and I'll be right beside you in your fight. I am coming. I am coming.
Yes, O Lord, we are coming.
We are coming. We are coming.
Huh? Yes, O Lord, we are coming.
Oh, Commander-in-Chief, when are you coming?
There they are.
Hail, O Master. I, along with my battalion, am just returning back from Nasik. And the news is that Lord Ram has won the battle against Kar and Dushan and their 14,000 soldiers.
Is this true?
Yes, O Lord. In fact, Lord Ram single-handedly slayed them all with a single arrow.
Bravo, Ram, bravo! Did you all hear this? My beloved Lord killed them all with a single arrow. How great my Lord is, how powerful and how supremely chivalrous he is. My heart is so gladdened to hear of this. This calls for celebration. Throw a royal feast to our subjects in all the three states of our kingdom. Donate cows, gold, and silk clothing. Give silver and copper utensils in charity to the needy. And let the glories of Raghunandan be sung day and night by esteemed musicians all over. May Lord Ram's victory be celebrated on a scale never seen before. Jai Shri Ram!
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 Well-deserved gift, huh?
Well, the king certainly thinks so.
To be honest,
it's all thanks to you all. I wouldn't mind reenacting the same role.
If such an opportunity arises again in the near future.
Such an opportunity won't arise again, my friend.
How can you be so sure about that?
Our king is addicted to hearing the Ramayana every day. We will instruct the reciter of the Ramayana to narrate only the happy pastimes from the Ramayana. And strictly refrain from narrating any disturbing or sad incident from it.
Sounds good. But what if the king goes into this zone like he did today? He'll be throwing celebrations after celebrations every day. Our treasury may well go empty.
Look, the king cannot do without his daily dose of the Ramayana. Now you tell me, as to which of these is a better scenario? A happy king throwing celebrations after celebrations, or a hyper fully worked up king, with an upraised sword in his hand, marching full speed again and again with his entire army to assist his lord in some goddamn fight which happened lakhs of years ago?
And thus, as per this new filter policy, the reciter of the Ramayana would only recite the happy pastimes from it.
And so, at a tender age, sage Vishwamitra took Ram and Lakshman away into the woods to kill all those troublesome demons who were constantly harassing the sages involved in performing yajnas for the welfare of mankind. King Dashrath was aggrieved at the prospect of sending his sons for such a dangerous mission, but his fears were quelled when Ram and Lakshman killed all the demons with their sharp arrows. Thus, they established themselves as the greatest of warriors.
Wonderful news. Yes, my lord is indeed the greatest of all warriors. Ministers, did you hear this? Please distribute cows, gold, and clothing to one and all. Feed everybody sumptuously. It is an occasion to celebrate.
Yes, O Lord.
On another day of hearing the Ramayana,
Prince Ram defeated all other princes who had come to win the hand of Devi Sita by accomplishing the impossible feat of lifting and stringing the powerful bow of Lord Shiva. Thus, Mother Sita was won by the only Purusha in all of creation.
Wonderful news. Ministers, did you hear this? Please distribute cows, gold, and clothing to one and all. Feed everybody sumptuously. It is an occasion to celebrate.
Yes, O Lord.
On yet another day of hearing the Ramayana,
after consultation with his ministers, Maharaj Dashrath took a decision to coronate Ram as the next king of Ayodhya.
Wonderful news. Ministers, did you hear this?
Yes, O Lord, we have heard the news. We will distribute cows, gold, and clothing to one and all. And we will feed everybody sumptuously. It is an occasion to celebrate.
How do you all know that I was going to say this?
Well then, get going.
Show me some fresh flowers.
How much is this for?
Fresh flowers are there.
Listen, O subjects, on the occasion of Lord Ram about to be coronated as the next king of Ayodhya, our king has declared that lavish celebrations be held across the kingdom.
Oh, the same old stuff again. Let's get back to shopping.
Looks like they haven't heard you properly. Announce loudly and more clearly now.
Dear subjects, looks like you haven't heard me properly. Our king has...
Dear sir, we have perfectly heard you. But please understand
that these daily celebrations have killed whatever enthusiasm is aroused upon hearing the word celebration. To celebrate has become so routine and boring nowadays.
And look at us. How much more gold do we need? Looks like the weight of gold on my body will be more than my weight if these celebrations keep happening every day. Honestly, for us, even gold has lost its shine now.
Dear sirs, at one point of time, I was just a bag of bones.
With some skin wrapped over it, just like him. And now look at me, I have become an elephant. Now, when I hear of the word celebration, my stomach curls at the thought of Rajbhog. All it yearns for is simple homemade food.
And celebration for what? For Ram being named as the successor to the throne of Ayodhya, knowing fully well that he was instead banished to the forest by the brainwashed Kaikeyi.
Or do we celebrate for this strange irony that although Ram had committed to marry only once, we keep getting him married to Mother Sita practically every alternate day?
It is not appropriate for the subjects to disregard their king, and especially a king as generous as him. And what is he asking of you? Just that you accept his largesse, his benevolence, and revel in the glory of the Lord. Is that so difficult for you to obey? Just remember this. You will not get another king as he, who loves his subjects so much. The praja of any other kingdom in this world will lop off their arms to have the fortune that you have.
She is right. The king loves us, and we too love him immensely. So let us wholeheartedly participate in his happiness. It is the duty of the subjects to be one with their king in his happiness and distress. Let's go.
Yes, yes, let's go.
She's right, let's go.
Yes, yes.
All right, get ready to grow. I mean, go.
And thus, the days in the kingdom were spent in joy and celebration. Meanwhile, the king himself was going deeper and deeper into his spiritual ecstasies. He would compose poems rich in devotion, and oftentimes, while doing so, he would identify himself with the person about whom he was writing. Sometimes he identified himself with the gopis of Vrindavan, and sometimes he would feel the pain of Mother Devaki.
Oh Krishna, how unfortunate I am. For even though I gave birth to you, I couldn't see you growing up. I've heard such wonderful things about your extraordinary pastimes, like stealing butter, your killing of various demons, your lifting of the Govardhana mountain, and your various mischievous tricks with the cowherd girls. Yashoda was the fortunate one. The torment of being imprisoned by my own brother in the dark dungeon for so many years. Even the agony of witnessing the brutal murder of my newborn infants in front of my own eyes is nothing compared to the pain I've undergone at being separated from you and having missed seeing you grow up, O Krishna. Having missed seeing you grow up. Oh, Krishna!
Listen, son. Today, I have to go out of town for some very important personal work. Kindly go to the king's place and recite from Ramayana on my behalf.
All right, father. I shall certainly do so.
You may leave now. It is time.
I'll leave right away. What's the matter, father?
I think that I'm forgetting something.
Forgetting what?
I remember that I'm forgetting something, but I am not able to remember as to what it is that I am forgetting. Nonetheless, you better get going now.
Okay.
The reciter indeed had forgotten something. Something very important. He had forgotten to tell his son that he strictly wasn't supposed to touch any sad or disturbing chapter from the Ramayana. Now one can well imagine the perils that could have arisen on account of this lapse. What then to speak of, knowing that the son directly touched upon the most heart-wrenching incident in the Ramayana, when
Ravana kidnaps Sita. He dragged the poor Sita by force. She resisted with all her might, but to no avail. She cried for help, the brave, but old Jatayu did try to protect her, but was no match to the powerful Ravana and lost his dear life. With no opponent in sight, the wicked Ravana took her away to Lanka. However, Lord Ram, along with his Vanasena, managed to find out her whereabouts and managed to reach Lanka. And
ministers!
Yes, O Lord.
My Prabhu Ram is fighting the very powerful Ravana and his mighty army. Even though the Lord is thoroughly competent to slay the enemy's entire army all by himself, it is our foremost duty to assist him.
Why are you looking at me like this? I didn't do anything.
Of course, you didn't do anything.
You better leave now. We have some rather serious issue to handle at the moment.
Oh Lord, please try to understand.
What is there to understand? It is you who has to understand that the most chaste lady in all of creation, the supreme goddess of fortune and the beloved wife of Prabhu Ram, has been kidnapped. And we Kshatriyas are duty bound to go to Lanka and assist the Lord in upholding Dharma.
But oh Lord, how do we convince you?
You don't convince the king. You follow his orders.
But it's Lanka, for God's sake.
So what if it's Lanka? I'd go to any part of the world if I could be of any use to the Lord. Chahe Bharat ho ya Lanka, ab bajega keval Ram ka hi danka.
And so, once again, King Kulashekar and his army marched full speed until they reached the shores of the ocean at Rameshwaram. Seeing the vast sea ahead, the army stopped. But King Kulashekhar was in a different zone altogether. There can be no material impediments on the path of bhakti. King Kulashekhar proved this true when, despite seeing the sea and no means to cross it, he got down from his chariot and, with his sword in hand, marched right into the sea all alone.
Oh Ram, I am coming. Your servant is coming to your aid.
Stop! O King, you will drown. Turn back.
Stop! Do not go any further. I am coming, O Ram. I am coming.
The king has gone berserk.
He will drown. Somebody stop him.
O Ram,
let's go and get some help.
O King, you are in illusion. Return back. You ain't going to find any Ram, Sita, Lakshman.
The Lord, being Bhakta Vatsala, can never not appear upon hearing the pure cry of his devotee. At that very moment, Lord Ram, whose lotus feet are sought after by the greatest of yogis and tapasvis, accompanied by Mother Sita and Brother Lakshman, appeared before King Kulashekhar.
Oh Lord, oh Master.
Oh Kulashekhar, you have drowned so deep into the ocean of love for me that you were not even aware that you were about to drown into this ocean. This desperation which you have for me, it is only by this very desperation that one can attain me. When one is willing to forsake his anything and everything, including his very life for my sake, it is then that I take charge of his life and guide him in such a way that he is sure to reach me. O Kulashekhar, I am immensely pleased with your devotion unto me, and for all of your love, I have nothing to repay you back with, except for my loving embrace.
Dear King, my Prabhu has won the war against Ravana, and I am now reunited with him. So you may now return to your kingdom and celebrate our victory, the way you have been celebrating all these years.
O Kulashekhar, know for certain that for ages to come, you will be celebrated as one of my most surrendered devotees. Your character will continue to inspire generations for millennia after millennia. And simply by chanting your glories, one will undoubtedly be purified and attain my lotus feet.
After this incident, King Kulashekhar felt severely choked, discharging his kingly responsibilities. Concerned with his mental disposition, the worried ministers held a meeting.
Earlier, when the king would talk about retiring, we brought saintly people into our kingdom so as to make him stay back. But in the process, he got addicted to hearing the Ramayana from them. And this addiction led to strange problems left, right and center. Thereafter, the filter policy solution also became a headache. Our treasury began drying up. Every time we have come up with a solution, it has only given rise to a bigger and bigger and bigger problem. All thanks to our king's unpredictable behavior.
And especially after the last episode, he's really serious about leaving the kingdom. For all we know, one fine morning he would be gone, even without informing us. It is a very grave situation, and there's nothing we can do about it.
I think I have a solution inside.
Well, speak up then. Why do you sound so apprehensive? Outrageous! This is completely wrong.
It is. But do we have a choice?
Or perhaps you can suggest a better measure.
All right, let's do it.
Impossible!
The lure of wealth and the comforts it can provide can corrupt the minds of the most pious men.
Yes, and this is exactly what has happened. Enjoying your blind trust and having been given a free hand, the pujaris have stolen the priceless Thiruvaratna Navmani jewelry of the deity of Krishna from our palace temple.
I do not believe any of this. The pujaris, they are Vaishnavas. And Vaishnavas cannot commit the sin of stealing the Lord's personal jewelry. In fact, they cannot commit any sin at all.
Dear King, it is precisely because of this implicit blind faith you have in them that they have misused your trust. Who else but they have the keys to the altar room?
Oh Lord, for far too long you have held the Vaishnavas to be infallible beings. However, today your faith in them has been shattered. We understand your turmoil. It is advisable that from now onwards you stop associating with them and devote more time on the affairs of your kingdom.
Who says my faith in them is shattered? Oh ministers, it is possible for the sun to rise from the west instead of the east. It is possible for a magnet to stop attracting iron filings onto it. It is possible that fire may lose its heat and instead have a cooling effect. But it is simply not possible that the pure devotees of the Lord can steal, and that too just some little piece of metal. The Vaishnavas possess Krishna, who is the reservoir of all treasure. Why would they indulge in something so petty and low? No. Still, because my ministers have doubts about their integrity, I consider it my duty to erase your doubts and protect their honor. Bring me a pot with the most deadly, venomous cobra inside it.
What exactly do you have in mind, sir? May I ask?
You shall find out soon.
As per the order of the king, a most venomous snake was brought in the presence of the king.
Oh, Madhusudana, today's the most unfortunate day. For the integrity of your devotees is on trial. In my heart, I have absolutely no doubt whatsoever about the purity of the character. Oh, Janardana, if my faith in your devotees is true, then may I not be bitten by this venomous cobra. However, if my faith is misplaced and they indeed have stolen your ornaments, then may I be bitten and let me die this very day.
No, Lord!
Please forgive us, O Master, for we falsely implicated the pujaris in this theft case. By doing so, we have committed a very grave offense. Very, very grave offense.
Actually, we do not have anything against them. It is only due to your excessive attachment to them that we hatched this outrageous plan. We were afraid that you would leave us behind and go away.
Yes, O King. Our only motive was to somehow or the other hold you back, because there is no one as competent as you to look after the kingdom and its subjects.
Kindly believe us. We love you. We just wanted you to remain with us. Please forgive us.
मज्जन्मना फलमिदं मधुकैतभारे मत प्रार्थनीया मत अनुग्रह एष एव त्वद भृत्य भृत्य परिचारक भृत्य भृत्य भृत्यस्य भृत्य इति माम स्मर लोकनाथ. The perfection of our lives, the most cherished mercy the Lord could show us would be for Him to consider us the servant of 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 his servant. Being in this position of Das, Dasanu Das, is the most exalted position we can ever aspire to. Oh Mudhas, today you have offended those very servants of the Lord who are so dear to him. You have offended those who are actually our masters. And in doing so, you have invited grave misfortune upon yourselves. If you really want to seek forgiveness, then go and fall at the feet of those whom you have offended. Only if they forgive you, do you stand a chance to be absolved of your sin. Because there is no greater offense than Vaishnava Prad. All these days, I was just pulling along with my administrative responsibilities. Not anymore. That very act by which you intended to hold me back has today become the catalyst for me to make that decision which I was all along deliberating upon. By this vile act of yours, you have just helped me reach a decision. Administration often involves deceit, manipulation, and conquest. and I want to do nothing with these anymore.
Today,
I, the representative of the actual king, Shri Anant Padmanabhji, resign from my kingship.
No, lordship, no!
Regardless of one's occupation, at the right time, one should let go of their positions, their attachments, and false identifications, and dedicate the remaining years of one's life in the loving remembrance of Lord Krishna. Else these very attachments will become the cause of perpetual bondage. The time factor is very powerful. It is Kal, which has put innumerable kings at the pinnacle of power. And it is Kal only which has ended their eras. Today, my era ends. My son Dhridavridhan will from this day onwards rule the kingdom. I hope you will guide him in the right direction and empower him to rule along the principles of Dharma.
King Kulashekar simply walked out of the kingdom, discarding it as if it were no more than a piece of stone. Thereafter, the temples in Srirangam, Kanchipuram and Tirupati became his shelter. As his glories gained legendary status, he was bestowed with the title Alvar, meaning one who dives deep into the personal attributes of the Lord. Alvar Kulashekar was the 10th among the 12 Alvars. He composed 105 Parshurams or poems, chief among which are The Rich in Devotion, Perumal Tirumozhi in Tamil, and the masterpiece work on Bhakti literature, the Mukund Mala Stotra, written in a manner such that each and every shloka appears to garland the transcendental name, form, and pastimes of Lord Mukunda. One shloka in particular from this literature was an all-time favorite of Srila Prabhupada, which he would quote time and again. Let us see as to what is it that Alvar Kulashekar had expressed through the shloka, which so captivated the heart of our beloved Acharya.
Krishna-tvadiya-pada-pankaja-panjarantam Adyaiva-me-vishatu-manasa-raja-hamsaha Prana-prayana-samaye-kaphavata-pittaihi Kanthavarodhana-vidhau-smaranam-kutaste
O Lord Krishna, let the royal swan of my mind enter the tangled stems of the lotus of your feet. Right now, I am hale and hearty. If I were to die now, I'd be very much protected because my mind is focused in your loving remembrance. If I were to wait for a natural death when I grow old, how will it be possible for me to remember you at the time of death, when my throat will be choked up with mucus, bile, and air? O Lord, I therefore plead with you with folded hands to please award me with death at this very instant. Please award me with death at this very instant, O Krishna. Please award me with death at this very instant.
Alvar Kulashekar is believed to have left his mortal remains at the age of 67 at Manarkovil near Tirunelveli. There is a temple called Kulashekar Alvar Koil, dedicated in honor of this great king, come poet, come saint, who exemplified the virtue of absolute absorption in loving remembrance of the lotus feet of Krishna.
श्री महाराज कुलशेखर की।
आरजी मीडिया यूट्यूब चैनल, लाइक शेयर सब्सक्राइब।